up, and feel free to stand while you talk, whatever works for you. So this is the Pennsylvania Prisons Racism and the Fight for Change panel discussion. We're going to have everyone speak for 10 minutes, and then we'll follow it by a Q&A. Give everyone a chance to talk and ask some questions. We are blessed with some incredible powerhouse leaders and community organizers on this panel today, and people that are doing really, really special work and very knowledgeable on these issues. I'm going to introduce the person as they speak so that you don't forget who they are by the time we get to them. And the first person speaking today is Shandre Delaney, and she's working with the Campaign to Abolish Solitary Confinement and the Human Rights Campaign, and we want to give her a warm welcome.
Thank you. Just a little bit about Human Rights Coalition. We're a grassroots nonprofit organization that consists of family members, ex-prisoners, and supporters. Our goals are to abolish prisons, to empower prisoner families to be active leaders in prison organizing, and to make visible and put to an end the injustice and abuse that is common within our judicial and prison systems in PA and across the country. The prison system is based on a foundation of exploitation, punishment, and corruption. Most of the people in prisons are poor, brown, urban, functionally illiterate, unemployed, or underemployed before they were locked down, and are there for nonviolent crimes. The prison system reflects all inequalities in our society, and it does not work in its current state. We also work to encourage the rehabilitation of prisoners. HRC understands that prisoners are human beings with problems that need to be addressed. Many prisoners have led lives of drug abuse, child abuse, or neglect, in addition to impacts of racism, sexism, classism, and homophobia. We as citizens should demand that the prison system focus on rehabilitation so that prisoners can return to society as a productive citizen. Currently, the HRC is involved in a campaign to abolish solitary confinement. Solitary confinement is the practice of confining a person in a tiny cell for 22 to 24 hours a day. Human beings are social creatures and need regular contact with other humans in order to maintain health, well-being, and sanity. Depriving a person of nearly all contact with others can cause irreversible psychological damage in as little as 2 weeks. We have developed a 3-point platform addressing why we think it should be abolished. I'll go over each point and then just give you some facts concerning that point. Our first point is solitary confinement is torture. The mentally ill become more unstable in this environment. Also in this environment, healthy prisoners begin to exhibit signs of mental illness in a very short time. Approximately 50% of suicides occur in solitary. Solitary targets mostly prisoners of color and those who have spoken out against abuse or those that file lawsuits. Many prisoners can come in with maybe a short 90-day sentence and end up doing years in solitary. Prisoners are abused sexually, psychologically, physically, whether male, female, or mentally handicapped. Our second point is that solitary confinement is a threat to public safety. At least 80,000 prisoners are held in solitary confinement, at least 2,500 of them in Pennsylvania. These conditions lead to self-harm, suicide, and violent tendencies. Prisoners brought back into general population and society with no mental health care results in violent altercations. Many prisoners have suffered months, years, and decades under torturous conditions and then are returned to society unable to cope, which increases violence in our communities. Our last point is solitary confinement must be abolished. Solitary confinement has become the dominant weapon in a war on prisoners that is in reality a war on our brothers, sisters, parents, children, families, and friends behind the walls. Torture is a crime and a serious threat to public safety, and it must be abolished. No other country in the world uses solitary confinement as much as the U.S. And even the special rapporteur from the UN has advised the United States that solitary confinement is torture. Part of the reason I'm familiar with Human Rights Coalition and solitary confinement is because my son, Carrington Keyes, has been a longstanding victim of racism and retaliation in the Pennsylvania Department of Correction. He became incarcerated in 1999 at the age of 18. He was buried in solitary and labeled as a security risk because he is a jailhouse lawyer and civil and human rights activist within the prison. Instead of going to the parole board in 2004, he was thrown into the dungeon where he was until 2012. He was housed among mentally ill inmates who screamed constantly and subjected to a bright light that burns day and night. That in itself is torturous and inhumane. He was starved to the point of losing 20 pounds and told by a staff nurse to take a timeout. He had his nose broken from being thrown down a flight of stairs while cuffed and shackled. He had requested camera movement whenever he's taken out of his cell, but they turn off the camera and beat him anyway. When any inmate on camera watch seeks to use the footage for evidence against the DOC, the guards say the camera has a malfunction. Well, this same malfunction happens at every prison. When inmates do complain or file lawsuits, they are retaliated against by receiving bogus misconducts, which are write-ups. The prison grievance system is a joke. The guards are part of the board, and they're not going to go against another guard. A blind eye is turned by judges, state police, and state representatives who have been presented with this evidence over and over throughout the years. When the inmates seek help from the outside officials, the complaint is sent back to the prison. The DOC is actually in charge of investigating itself. Guards regularly conduct contraband searches to remove legal documents from cells of inmates who have pending legal cases against them or the DOC. Because my son was only 18 when he entered prison, I was worried about abuse from other prisoners, but later came to find out it's not the Crips, the Bloods, or the pedophiles that he needed to worry about, but the prison guards and staff. The COs are so arrogant and lawless that even after an inmate, Andre Jacobs, won a lawsuit against them, they still continue to abuse him. Currently, my son and five other inmates, collectively known as the Dallas Six, are in a legal battle with the DOC. An HRC abuse report on torture was released featuring SCI Dallas, which set in motion targeted beatings of African-American inmates. After being told that they were next to be beat, these men peacefully covered their cell windows and asked to speak with media and outside officials to voice their complaints of racism and torture. The response was to put on riot gear and violently extract the prisoners. And after that, they were tortured, they were tasered, and beat and left bloody for up to 12 hours. And after that, they were emergency evacuated to other prisons. My son and these other six guys filed complaints against the DOC and the DA of Luzerne County about the situation that happened to them at Dallas. Coincidentally, months later, in retaliation, they were charged with riot. A federal judge has granted my son an injunction hearing because he feels that there may be some merit to his belief that there are retaliatory motives involved by the DOC. Carrington has accomplished what many inmates have not been able to. He has been successful in getting a day in court against the DOC for their abuse and retaliation. On January 9, 2013, a hearing was held in federal court for abuse and retaliation by the DOC. The case was ended in a mistrial, and after that, he had a chance to talk to the jury, and the jury told him that they did not believe anything that the guard said, and they did agree that he was unanimously that he was abused and retaliation, but they could not agree that he was, that it was malicious. In conclusion, I just want to say that the Human Rights Coalition calls on all people to demand the abolition of solitary confinement in Pennsylvania. Together, we will build a society that respects the rights of all people, values rehabilitation, and does not believe in throwaway people. If you have any incarcerated family members, please be aware that there is truth to them being victimized by guards. And if you need information about HRC, you can go to hrcoalition.org. And any information about Carrington, you can go to sci6.blogspot.com.
As you can see, we're getting the trail of incredible work that people have done. So we're going to continue on with Martha Conley. She's here today speaking as a member of the Pennsylvania for Alternatives to the Death Penalty and Pennsylvania Prison Society. And we're going to hear a little bit about the death penalty and political prisoners. Welcome her, please.
I'm going to stand so you can hear me. The Commonwealth of Pennsylvania currently has 204 people on death row. And we have actually the fourth largest death row in the country. I'm probably preaching to the choir, but for those of you who don't know these statistics, I do want to go through them. California has over 700 people on death row. Florida's next. Something like 600. Texas is next, and then Pennsylvania. Just to put that in perspective, the state of Virginia has about 6 people on death row. Let's see if I can read this. If you're interested in getting more information about the death penalty in the United States, you can go to the Death Penalty Information Center, and they have fact sheets on each state. And I just want to cover some of the facts about Pennsylvania. There have been 3 executions in Pennsylvania since the death penalty was reinstated in Pennsylvania in 1976. All of those people were so-called volunteers. They were mentally ill, and the Commonwealth let them give up their right to further appeal, and they accepted death. The U.S. Supreme Court actually did away with the death penalty in 72 because they said it wasn't functioning in an appropriate manner. The system was broken. But the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania reinstated the death penalty in 1974. We've been sort of lulled into a false sense of security, although my organization has been working to abolish the death penalty in Pennsylvania, but no one has been actually executed since 1995. Nobody has been executed in Pennsylvania since 1999. But that's going to end because several people who are incarcerated on death row right now are in danger. And in fact, someone came within hours of execution in October of this year, of 2012. So our moratorium campaign, we're working towards a moratorium, and it's very important that we let our legislators know and the governor know that we think that there should be a moratorium on the death penalty, meaning that the death penalty should not be utilized, especially since there's a commission who's studying the death penalty right now. And there should certainly be no executions until they finish their work, which will be in about another year and a half. There are, included in that number of 204, there are 4 women on death row. Most of the death row inmates are housed in about an hour from here at SCI Green in Greene County. And the women on death row are usually housed at Cambridge Springs. Not too long ago, there were about 238 people on death row in Pennsylvania. And for various reasons, that number has dwindled. Juveniles can no longer be executed, according to the Supreme Court. So they were taken off of death row. People who are mentally retarded, the U.S. Supreme Court said, should not be subject to execution. They were removed from death row. And perhaps most importantly, a number of death penalty decisions have been overturned because of excellent appellate work by the federal defenders in Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. And that brings up a point about the death penalty, about the disparity between the resources that the district attorneys have, prosecutors have, and the resources that the defendants have to pursue or to defend against their death penalty claims. The prosecutors have almost unlimited resources. They can pay for all kinds of experts to testify. They can pay for DNA in the appropriate case, DNA testing. And most of the people who are sitting on death row were represented by public defenders or appointed counsel. And public defenders and appointed counsel don't get the money that prosecutors do for investigators, for expert witnesses, and so forth. Most of the resources are put to the appellate level. Once somebody's been in jail for 10, 15, 20 years, they get to the federal level and they get excellent counsel in some cases, and that's why a number of people have come off death row in Pennsylvania. The other thing about the death penalty is that prosecutors often don't really want the death penalty, but they use it to force people to plead guilty. Now, in any other context, that would be considered extortion, which is illegal. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But in the death penalty context, it's routine. So what happens is, in order to avoid getting a death sentence, you plead guilty to life in prison. And that happens even if you're innocent. Innocent people will plead guilty to avoid the death penalty, and they end up sitting on life row. The interesting thing about the criminal justice system is it's illegal to lie to the police. So if you're interrogated by the police, you can be prosecuted if you lie to them, you tell them something, give them some falsehood. But there's no law that says that they can't lie to you. And my favorite example of that is a case, I think it was out in Iowa someplace, where a young man's parents were killed, and the police decided that he did it. And he kept telling them, no, I had nothing to do with this crime. And so finally the police said, well, we happen to know you did it because before your father died, he told us that you were the one who killed him. So the kid says, well, if my dad said that, I must have done it. So he pled guilty. And he ended up spending 10, 15 years on death row. And it wasn't until he got appellate counsel that he was able to unravel the fact that they had lied to him about that. And it turned out that a motorcycle gang had come through his town, and they lived on a farm way out in the country, and they were the ones that had killed his parents. So those are the kinds of things that happen with our criminal justice system. I used to think, before I got involved in this work, that the people who were in jail belonged there, and that everybody who was convicted was guilty. In fact, I spoke at the Church of the Redeemer Thursday evening, and somebody said, well, how can you be convicted if you're innocent? And that's the kind of thing that I would have asked when I started this work. Yeah. how can that happen? Well, it happens very easily because there's police misconduct, prosecutorial misconduct, just all sorts of things that happen in a trial. And if you don't have good counsel and you don't have a good investigator and you don't have resources to really mount a good defense, you're going to be convicted, whether you're innocent or guilty. So those are some of the things that I wanted to talk about, the death penalty, just to give you some information about it. The death penalty is, a lot of people say, well, the death penalty is a deterrent. It's for the victim, but it's really not for the victim or the victim's family. It's really to serve the criminal justice system, because people use it as a stepping stone to higher political office. If you look around the state, people who are serving in the governor's office, on the PA Supreme Court, Castile is a former Philadelphia prosecutor, Rendell, former Philadelphia prosecutor. So people use the death penalty as a stepping stone, not because it's a deterrent, because it really is not. I mean, even police officials will tell you that it's not a deterrent to homicide or crime. In fact, I like to say that if it were actually a deterrent, Texas would be homicide-free by now. Mm-hmm. And when I talk about indigent defense, it's not that public defenders are bad lawyers. It's that they're so overwhelmed with cases, and they just don't have the resources, and they have too many cases, and they really aren't in a position to render adequate legal representation. The other thing about victims' families, a lot of them are opposed to the death penalty because of the long time it takes for a case to get through the system. And so they have to come back and relive the horror over and over again. They have to come to hearings, appeal hearings, and you know, there are many people who've been in prison for 10, 15, 20, 30 years, and they're still fighting their convictions. And so victims' families often want to get past the trauma and put it behind them, but our system of criminal justice doesn't let them do that.
If you want to say a last comment.
I'm sorry, I was supposed to talk about political prisoners. I did want to mention the Move 9, who are in prison in Pennsylvania. Nine people were charged, there are eight now, one of them died. Nine people were charged with homicide of a single police officer. And they were sentenced to 30 to 100 years in prison. They're still there. Several of them are women. They're housed at Cambridge Springs. And the city of Philadelphia, the police department, did not like the Move 9 because of their political philosophy. So they framed them. It appears that they were, that actually the bullet came from the police and not from them. So I just wanted to mention that.
Thank you.
I think it's important, you know, I want to say thank you to all of you because I know this room is very sensitive to the sound, so I know you're all having to be as quiet as a church mouse, right? So thank you for that, because that takes effort. And just to remember as we're hearing these speeches and talks, how much time and work and heart is put into all of the elements that each panelist is talking about. And just having respect for that. So thank you for being quiet. We're going to move on. Now I'm introducing Gloria Scotts-Johnson. She's been in the struggle for a long time, and she's been working on focuses of criminalization with juveniles. She's part of the Black Political Assembly, Your Sister Project, and Parents Against Violence. Please give her a warm welcome.
Thank you for allowing me to speak today.
to all my fellow soldiers that's out there that's been in the movement for a long time. The struggle still goes on. I want to talk about kids for cash. It sounds like it's a ridiculous thing, but it's really not. It goes on every day. It's right there before our eyes, and we just can't see it because we don't believe what we're looking at. And I'm so glad to see these young men here. And I don't see any young girls, but however, that's where it starts. It starts in the schools. Say, for instance, they're in special education, or they're just a kid that gets on somebody's nerve, anybody. So that child is marked, even at this young age. He's a troublemaker. So they have them in a completely, as a former teacher, they have them in a completely different category, period. They're just not wanted, period. So what we've learned to do is we're figuring out, you know, how did this Kids for Cash scandal started? It started in the schools. That's my point there. And it started because they start building these little jailhouses, I call them, but they're like boot camps, you know, houses not houses anymore. They have like big buildings now because they get the contracts. And what happened was that the people in the middle of the state, Luzerne County again, whatever's going on in Luzerne,
that's where
it started there for the media blitz that went on with the Kids for Cash. I don't know if anybody's aware of it here, but it has a long standing, and then you can get it at Wikipedia.com and get all of the information, you know, for those who are still interested, because I won't have the time to describe the abhorrent and the deplorable conditions that they have all of this in. It's just a total mess across the country. You know, don't think it's just in Pennsylvania. It's not. And it's in the same category as most criminality in the justice system, and I call it criminality because they're supposed to be the ones, the keepers of the gate, so to speak. But nobody's watching the gate, evidently. What happened was so outrageous until three judges have been adjudicated now in prison, even though they're soft prisons. You know, they got a lot of time. And I'll give you some of the stats. Okay, it says it unfolded in 2008. That's when they publicized it. It was a judicial kickback at Luzerne County Courts of Common Pleas in Wilkesboro, Pennsylvania. The judge president was Mark Crivelli, senior judge, and Michael Cohen was accused of accepting kickbacks for connecting the facilities and imposing harsh sentencing on juveniles before their courts to increase numbers of inmates in designated centers. For example, Crivelli, he received children to extend his stay in juvenile detention for offenses as minimal as mocking a principal on MySpace, trespassing in a vacant building, shoplifting a DVD from Walmart. Crivelli and Cohen pleaded guilty in February 13th in 2009, pursuant to a plea agreement to the federal charge of honest service fraud and conspiracy to defraud the United States government. In other words, failing to report income tax to the Internal Revenue. So this was, then they called it the pay for child care in prison. And it's called child care, and the other one is Western Pennsylvania child care in Butler County. The plea agreement was later voided by a federal judge who was dissatisfied with the post-plea conduct of the defendants, and the two judges charged withdrew their guilty pleas, raising the possibility of a criminal trial. The federal grand jury in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, returned a 48-count indictment against Crivelli and Cohannon, including racketeering, fraud, money laundering, extortion, bribery, and federal tax violation. This happened in September. I'll just make this story a little bit shorter so I can expound on the my interest, and hopefully your interest, is the children. Over 6,000 children were adjudicated. Allegheny County,
all of the counties all together, the six, that was wrongfully adjudicated, not just adjudicated, there's more, much more children than that. Because this is a cash cop. You know, when you say kickback, we're just thinking of maybe a detective or a policeman. You know, no. It goes much further than this. They get the building built by the state, number one, with our tax dollars. And they close people that are even halfway trying to do it right. They close them down because they don't play the game with them, you know. And it's really mind-boggling to any kind of conscious person. You know, they're doing this to our children. You know, for a DVD stealing out of Walmart, or hollering or screaming at a teacher, or saying something on Facebook, which, you know, it's social media. It's supposed to be free. You're supposed to be able to say what you want to say, except, you know, start a fire or haul a fire or whatever it is. But it's just something that we need to be aware of, because we've been brought up to believe that people who are in authority, particularly teachers, would have nothing to do with this. It goes, like I said, at the school. Okay, they get into the juvenile justice system. Somebody's calling up and saying, oh, we got another one for you. Uh-huh. Instead of getting a slap on the wrist, or even they shouldn't even be there, they're getting, like, jail sentencing. I mean, we wouldn't call it jail sentencing in the sense, but it is jail sentencing. And these children's lives are irreparably harmed and forever. You know, they say they don't look back, that's a lie.
Yes.
That's a big lie. And for instance, my son was in a fight where some man had raped this girl, and him and his friends got together and beat the man up. And the judge told him they were wrong, but they used that against him in a trial that he had. And, Claire, would you come up here and take over and tell them what you knew? I got something in my eye, so.
If you want, if you're comfortable, you can join us up here. If you'd like, you can move on to another panel, so come back. It's okay. If you'd like to talk, you can come up here, and if you would like, we can move on the panel.
I can contribute. Can you stand up?
Do you want to talk? Or
I can contribute from the audience a little later.
Later. Okay, that's fine. And I'll check on Gloria in a second when I've introduced the next panelist. But hopefully she'll be okay. I know we're all thinking about her right now. So, are you comfortable for me?
Yeah.
Okay, so now I'm going to introduce, we'll get back to Gloria, okay? I'm going to go check on her. Don't worry. That's my number one priority. But we're going to introduce Devon Cohen, who works with the Human Rights Campaign, and also Decarcerate-PA. And move on. Thank you. Everybody give Devon a welcome.
Devon, and mostly I work with Shandre with the Human Rights Coalition, but I've done a little bit of work with Decarcerate-PA, which is mostly based in Philly. Oh, sure. Okay. Try. Shout at me if you can't hear me. And Decarcerate-PA is a grassroots campaign to end proposed prison expansion in Pennsylvania. And like I said, it's mostly based in Philly. I'm really excited about this project. I've done a little bit of work with them, but I haven't done a ton, so I'm not really an expert. But I'll tell you what I know. So right now what's happening in Pennsylvania is $685 million are slated to expand prisons in the state. That includes building three new prisons, one of which is already completed, and expanding nine other prisons. On the whole, this will add 5,000 to 8,000 new prison beds in the state. That disparity depends on whether or not they end up closing one prison, SCI Greater Bird. So there's two prisons being built in Montgomery County that are supposed to replace SCI Greater Bird. They're on the same grounds, called SCI Phoenix 1 and 2. That includes an additional 100 beds in death row and also a women's unit. And then there's a 2,000 bed prison that I said is already built in Rock, or in Center County, on the site of SCI Rockview. The double prisons cost $400 million, that project. The other prison, $200 million. The rest of that, $685, is spread out throughout the state. So taking it back a little bit, Pennsylvania's incarceration rate has increased 500% since 1980. Mm. There used to be around 8,000 prisoners in 1980, now there's over 50,000. So that's like a crazy rate of increase of incarceration in this state. And over the last 30 years, the DOC budget, Department of Corrections budget, has increased more than 1,700%. It's the third largest department in the general fund budget now in this state. And at the same time, right now, Governor Corbett has made huge cuts to education, medical assistance, social services, tons of other things that actually help communities and prevent them from going to prison in the first place. And in the 2012-2013 budget alone cuts $264 million to higher education, $319 million to general assistance, $21.6 million to Philadelphia's public schools. They're closing 64 public schools in Philadelphia and building prisons. Pretty clear example of the priorities of the administration of the state right now. There's also, like, the way that it's happening is just extremely inefficient. Like, they could, if they wanted to reform things, do a lot with what they have. The current parole process keeps thousands of people incarcerated past their minimum release dates. A year ago, in January 2012, just for that month, there were 2,339 people who remained in prison after their release date, after they'd been approved for parole. A lot of them probably because they couldn't pay the $60 required release fee, which is crazy. And people are sitting in jail because they're on waiting lists to get on parole mandated programming. It costs almost $33,000 a year to house in prison. So it's just crazy. People are sitting in jail and they can be getting out. It's costing our communities, it's costing the people, it's costing the state. It doesn't make any sense. So instead of resolving these efficiencies, they're just throwing money to locking more people up. So onto Decarcerate-PA, that's where the backdrop. Decarcerate-PA started in Philly about almost 2 years ago, and it started sort of as like a grouping coalition of folks who had already been doing prisoner support work and reentry service work, and people were learning about this prison expansion and thinking about how that was going to affect the work that they were doing and also like the human cost of that, and started organizing to fight that. So they started this campaign to end prison expansion. And they also have a three-part platform, kind of like HRC's Abolish Solitary campaign, and I'll just read it. The Decarcerate-PA platform. One, no new prisons. Enough is enough. That Pennsylvania enact an immediate and lasting moratorium on all new prisons, county or city jails, prison expansions, new beds in county jails, immigrant detention facilities, and private prisons. Mm-hmm. Two, decarceration. Prison overcrowding can be solved only by reducing the number of people in prison. We advocate that Pennsylvania shrink its prison population by reforming existing arrest, sentencing, and parole practices. We also call for the full restoration of civil and human rights for formerly incarcerated people. And three, community reinvestment. Imprisonment guts local resources and destroys communities. We need to build communities, not prisons. We advocate that Pennsylvania reinvest money spent on prisons into community institutions, including quality public schools, stable housing, jobs and job training programs, healthcare and food access, drug and alcohol treatment programs, and community-based reentry services. So that's the sort of three core initiatives that Decarcerate-PA is going forward with. And since starting, I don't know if any of y'all have heard of Decarcerate-PA before, but at least in the eastern half of the state, they've got a huge amount of momentum. There's like a bunch of stuff happening. They're doing things all the time, and they've been getting a lot of press and gaining a lot of speed, which is really exciting and interesting. So I wanted to go over some of the things that have been happening through Decarcerate. So they launched the platform, and so far over 80 organizations have signed onto the platform. And they've been having a ton of different actions and rallies and things going on. There's a couple big ones that I wanted to mention. They had a huge rally in collaboration with some other organizations, teacher organizations, and other prisoner support groups. in Philadelphia outside of a place where Corbett was speaking, and that they were big enough and loud enough that they could be heard on the inside of this meeting, which made a really interesting media link through NPR that got brought up inside the meeting and then created an opportunity for folks from Decarcerate to have a meeting with John Wetzel, the Secretary of the Department of Corrections, and then debated him on the radio, on Radio Times.
Wow.
It's awesome. It's a super good radio interview or thing. You should check it out. It's on the internet. And after that, they had a really cool social media campaign for the entire month of June on Tumblr. They posted pictures. They went out and put a prison cot at a location that was being negatively affected by cuts in Pennsylvania. Took a picture of it, put it on Tumblr, and that gained a lot of attention for what was happening. There also was a civil disobedience action a month or 2 months ago, and they shut down prison construction for an hour at SCI Greaterford, the two prisons that are being built there. Seven people were arrested. It may or may not be the first civil disobedience action at a prison construction site. That also got a lot of attention. They've been doing tons of other stuff too. So for what's happening right now, on January 9th, the Corbett administration stated that they would be closing two prisons, SCI Crescent and SCI Greensburg, when the prison, I forget what it's called, but the one that's happening where Rockview is now, is going to be opened in June. Which is interesting, especially because SCI Crescent is currently under investigation from the Department of Justice, mostly for warehousing and mistreating mentally ill prisoners. And there was an op-ed that was recently published by, written by two folks from Decarcerate in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. I don't know if any of y'all saw it. It's really good. So I kind of wanted to bring that up because they brought up a pretty important framing of these prison closures. And so the closures were justified with the opening of a new prison. And John Wetzel claims that the state will save $23 million a year with these closures, which would be great if they weren't planning on continuing to spend $400 million on building two new prisons, which is important to keep in mind. And Wetzel is also kind of being lauded as this prison reformer. He's like passing different laws that involve reform, and some like kind of inches forward are being made, but like big steps backward are being made at the same time. He claims that he's interested in reducing the prison population, but the only way that this can actually happen, instead of like shutting and closing and opening and shutting prisons, is by actually enacting substantive sentencing and parole reform and reinvesting in things that make communities healthy and safe, like jobs and education, housing, medical care. Also, there has not been any guarantee that the prisons, Crescent and Greensburg, are actually going to be permanently closed. In 2005, SCI Pittsburgh was closed, justifying the opening of two other prisons, SCI Fayette and SCI Forest. Barely 2 years later, SCI Pittsburgh was open again, and now it's filled to capacity. So we might just be getting three inefficient prisons in one place instead of two. So yeah, like I said, those prison closures are a small step in the right direction, but there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. And if anybody is interested in getting involved with this, folks from Philly are planning to come out here in March sometime and sort of start more cross-pollination throughout the state and get a bigger, more step happening in Pittsburgh. So if you're interested, we should talk later.
So Lori's back. Okay.
Yeah, I just had a little hair in my eye, and it was, you know, it's irritating. So, I don't want you to think I'm sitting up here crying, even though it's enough to cry about. But
so we're gonna give her 5 more minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you. What I wanted to finish saying, I noticed by heart, it's just so awful that I took up this cause because I see a lot of children's lives being ruined. From the inside out, it could be as simple as your mother didn't pay her gas bill. That was one instance of that I read up on. And so they come in, the state, and they get the kids, and some of them act up wherever they send them to, and then they just go further up. And as far as plea bargaining, that goes on even at that level. And as far as the public defenders, they're the plea bargainers because, like someone said, it's because they don't have the financial money to deal with these things, and there's so many that they have on their caseload. Till all these things just get put by the wayside. This is like the appeal that even a youth can have. They ignore them because, for the most part, they're sending them there for the cash. You know, we won't look at the cash part of this, and this is what I want us to open our eyes and look at the cash cow that's going on. It's on the stock market. You know, IBM's invested. You know, AT&T's invested. So this is a cash cow. And it's not so much that we're trying to say that there are not some youth who don't need some type of surveillance in that area or even being housed in the right type of way to try to help them. But usually what happens, even with all this blood that's shedding in the streets now, and it's much, they're getting younger and younger, the perpetrators, younger and younger, not older and older, younger and younger. Okay, they get to the point where they've usually been inside the system one way or the other. You think, oh, well, that's good. We're not going to bring him back home until he learns his lesson. But while he's over there in one of them boot camps, he's learning a lot of lessons. Yeah. And none of them are productive. You know, we don't insist that there's a certain criteria for education.
That's right.
Or even if they're mentally balanced, we don't, you know, it's just like we don't care, just as long as they're out of sight. But we're not looking at the end where it says, okay, they're out of sight, but why are they out of sight so long? They were supposed to only do 90 days. Well, they've been in there for a year. Because each bed makes someone mentioned the price of incarceration. Mm-hmm. Well, with children, it could go on much longer than even with adults because they really don't have a voice. I seen a young girl one day, we went to help. She was shackled. You know, the way they even bring them into the juvenile court, any kind of trial, they shackle them like animals. If you treat a person like an animal, they're going to act like an animal. You know, it's just that simple. They shackled her down. She was 14 years old to go to her mother's funeral. Now, all these great big men that they have, you can't tell me they couldn't have three or four hold that girl, and all she had really was a big mouth. If you want to be, you know, she had a big mouth. You know, she had a couple of mouths that we say. And another thing I wanted to look at is the intolerance. What started out as something good, it was called the No Child Left Behind. And then it became zero tolerance. You know, you weren't allowed to do anything in school. Bring a gum, bubble gum, you know, anything. Doesn't make any difference what we can think of. Throw a paper. You know how they throw them airplanes in class and all like that? You know, he comes from a dysfunctional family. You know, he beats all the criteria. Next thing you know, he's been, you know, tooted up to one of these halfway houses, boot camps. You can call them anything you want to call them. You know, but the bottom line is that I have 2 minutes. Okay. So let me, the bottom line is that I just hope more people become aware of what we're doing with our children. Whether it's in a school that starts this stuff, or whether it's just in a playground area or something, and try to teach our children, you know, to be responsible and respectful. And you know, you can't go along to get along all the time, but that's what most children do. It just comes with the territory of being a child. You don't want to be an outcast. So you might be throwing a rock that broke a window. Well, we don't know that in the back of the day, it was like, okay, your kids are going to pay for my window. And that would be it, which is fair. That's it, exactly. Well, that child ends up in the system. Not one, all five. Okay? So that's what I'm saying. We need to keep our eyes open, open, and open even more. And the church has a lot to do with this, too. You know, if we could just get the churches to be more involved with our youth, at every level, you know. In the medical profession, you know, everybody has a part in this because the system is so huge. I can tell you, I don't know half of them. You know, it has tentacles that you don't even know where they reach. You know, by the time you get to a federal judge and three of them are in jail now, something's really wrong. You know, they're doing like, one has up to, Cohen has up, he gets out in 26, the other one gets out in 39, and there's another one that was a lawyer that was getting all the money together for him to get these buildings, to build it up for these kids. So it's a big scam, you know, and it's sad that I have to stand here and say this as a United States citizen, you know, but that's where your tax dollars are going, and we should be ever conscious of where our tax dollars go.
Okay, so superheroes up here. We've gotten to our finale here. This is Terrell Johnson. He has, some of you probably know him. He's been released after 17 years wrongly convicted as being in prison for 17 years, and he's part of two organizations, Fed Up and Poor Law, starting to do a lot of work locally to get people organized. So I'd like to give him a warm round of applause. And
said on this panel, if I was to talk about it while I'm in prison, or if I reach back out into society, it just make me feel like it's just a conspiracy. You know, I'm just talking, you don't know what you're talking about. The only thing people respect is the number and the actual facts. And y'all have the facts. The sad part about it is most people don't see or think that it could affect them. I've said it over and over, man. These people just snatched me out of my life. Whatever my life consisted of 17 years ago, they took me physically, handcuffed me, and put me on trial for my life. Made me defend my life. Didn't do anything wrong. I wasn't nowhere near the scene of the crime. But because their backs were against the wall, because the system was under attack. At the time, this is 1994, the type of murder, the state witness that got killed, there was no such thing as a witness protection program. No such thing in Pittsburgh. The term wasn't even here. But this case brought about that type of language. Now it's all about mob hits. I've challenged people, man, to this day. Where's this mob at? Where's this gang that I was supposed to be a part of? This murderous crew, man, that just killed state witnesses. It wasn't real. But they drummed up all of this stuff in the media. Gator public is scared. And once they start saying that stuff to y'all start believing it. Y'all really start reading these newspapers like, oh, these niggas down here in these communities, man, they really, you know, we need to be scared of them. They don't even know me. These people snatched me out of my life and had no clue as to who I was. But they gave me an identity. Meanwhile, people in my community, they're fighting and saying y'all got the wrong person. We're not saying that some of these guys won't bust your head, steal your purse. We're not saying that. But that guy right there, he didn't do that. Didn't matter to me. A lot of those people, man, that were involved in my life being taken away, they should be put on trial. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? That was attempted murder that they put down, man. They tried to put a needle in my arm for a crime I did not commit. This is how real it got. At 19 years old, I sat there, and I didn't know anything. I didn't know, and I'm telling you honestly, if I'd have known better, man, I'd have choked the life out of my lawyer, man. I'd have choked him. Like, he really didn't put one witness up on my behalf, man. And the two people, man, that could have saved my life, he subpoenaed them. And they were sitting right behind me while this trial was going on, man. Closing arguments. Yo, what's up? Put my witnesses on. Oh, no, it's cool. It's cool. What do you mean? What do you mean? Later on in my appeal process, and I got a post conviction. I had an opportunity for a new trial, and the judge brought this lawyer in, and he asked him, "Well, why didn't you put his witnesses on the stand?" He says, "Oh, because one of them was 6 months pregnant." Exactly, right? The Third Circuit Court of Appeals, when they read that, they were like, "Did that have to do with anything?" But they still denied the appeal. This is how crazy this stuff got. If it wasn't for people in this community that really believed, that stepped out on faith and fought for me, and I'd be just like so many others, man, sitting in there just dead. Like, all my appeals were done, man. They denied every single appeal that I put in with proof in their face that their witness, only one lady, a crackhead, they gave deals to. And it still, to this day, hasn't been determined who brought up the conversation about the deals. Like, if you're a citizen and you're doing the right thing, why do you get the escape punishment for the crimes that you've committed against the SAC? What made her better than me? But they entered into all type of deals in order to get this testimony from her, knowing that she was lying. They did the background check on who this woman was, and it didn't matter. My life didn't matter to them. There was something bigger at work as far as they were concerned. And I ultimately ended up getting my life taken away. But I say on the other end of it, shame on you. Because now I know, and I'm going to tell on you busters every chance that I get.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Never allowed me into that situation, because now I know, like, what they're talking about and what y'all all may understand, I'm telling you, firsthand knowledge, man, it's crazy behind them gates. And they're abusing people. They run that prison, man, like it's a concentration camp. With gangs, man. You cannot go against that. They will disappear you into one of them holes, man. You got any type of radicalness in you at all, they will, okay, pack his property. Matter of fact, don't even pack his property up. Cuff him. He gone. And they won't see you. You'll be walking around the compound like, man, what up? They've been in the hole. It's 3-4 years later. Like, is he really still in the hole? One of my best friends, man, did a year in the hole. It came out. He was not the same person, man. And they will sit you there year after year after year. Some of these guys are back there throwing feces on each other, on the guards, man. And these are guys, man, that have dates. They're coming back into society. And they will release them. On their match day, they will release them from the hole back into society. What chance do they stand? This is the type of stuff that's going on. But the general public, man, they don't think that it has anything to do with them. I talked to one of my supervisors on the job about my case. Gave me the material to read. I said, I'm not going to try to convince you of anything. Read it for yourself. He says, I believe you didn't have anything to do with it. I see what I see. But you must have done something to put yourself in that position. I was mad at my own business. Television came on. My son came out the room, said, yeah, you on the news. Wanted for capital murder. You and two other guys. Two guys that I don't even hang with. What makes a lot of people think that it can't be them? Like, it can be, man. And I think, man, for me, that's the message for me. Don't think that it can't be you. Because when it benefits their agenda, whoever they are, white, black, I'm not gonna put a white face on it. I'm not, because the DA that tried me is white. I mean, black. Boss might have been white, but she's black. Had no regard for my life. Wasn't for my wife, like I said, man, and the people in this community, man, I'd still be in there. There's no way. And since I've been home, I've been working on behalf of those who don't know life. Y'all see these young men right here? This is my work right here. This is me and my wife's work. They ain't sitting on no corner or nothing like that, selling no drugs. Like, they got their issues. They got their issues, trust me. I know y'all have seen a couple of them get chastised already. But it's worth it. I owe them. I owe them. It's life or death for them. They don't realize it right now, but it's life or death. I'm not letting near one of them go. Y'all can't have it. And that's just our attitude. You can't have it.
Powerhouse. She's a part of Haywood. She has definitely led and pioneered the campaign to make sure Terrell finally got served justice, and has done incredible work. I'm sure many of you know her, and it's starting for law, and it continues to be part of what makes Pittsburgh a worthy place to live. So give her a welcome, too.
What I would like to say, and I'd like to touch on what the ladies up here was
talking about for is it's really school pipelines to prison pipelines. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what it is. What they do now is they try to diagnose our children being ADHD. They're not. That's just another way to get them in that system. You know what I mean? Ain't nothing wrong with them. They eat too much sugar. That's all it really is, for real. It's too much sugar. I go down and I pray with the children in the morning when they go to school. And when you see these children, they're going to the local stores getting candy, chips, juice, pops, and all that. Ain't no ADHD. When I never heard that, like, for real, so much. As much as I'm hearing it now. Ain't nothing wrong with our children. You know what I mean? We got some issues, but all that, you know, trying to diagnose them, saying that something's wrong with them, they cutting up because of this. No, they need a good old-fashioned butt whooping. Period. But they try to take that away from us. You know what I mean? Oh, you hit your child, you're going to jail. Yeah, okay, well, send me, because I'm whooping them. Period. Because if I don't whoop them, they won't be in front of y'all. They won't be in front of y'all, so take me to jail because I'm whooping them. And I always say, you know what I mean, like, they got our children set up for failure. You know what I mean? They putting them in these classrooms, they got 25 to 30 students, teacher 21, 22 years old, they're not listening. They're not going to listen. You know what I mean? So I don't know what made y'all, and they all learn at a different level. You know what I mean? You're not going to get them all to comprehend at one time. You're just not going to get it. And they're trying to push that curriculum in them in 2 weeks. You got to learn this in 2 weeks because that's what the people at the board is telling them. You got to make sure they learn this in 2 weeks. Everybody don't learn the same. Everybody do not learn the same. And there used to be teacher's assistants in these classrooms. They done took them out. And they putting them in, and like I said, they're putting them in that juvenile court system because it's just another way to send them to the prison. Mm-hmm. It's a setup. Period. It's a setup. Now, if you get somebody to come out and they really, you know, because they'll come to places like this, but come out in our community. Mm. You know what I mean? Come to our community. You know, be a part of these communities, and then we'll say maybe you can. But when you're sitting on when you're in the juvenile court system and you're hearing these cases and stuff, you could never really hear our cases or our cries in our communities. Mm-hmm. You can never understand where we're coming from unless you walk into our shoes. Mm-hmm. You can't feel us. You can only hear and speculate. But it's real. And if we don't get our babies right now, they headed for a road of destruction. Mm-hmm. Not on my clock. Not on my clock. Y'all had them long enough. Mm. Y'all had them long enough. And like me and my husband said, if we can give them that knowledge, we're going to give it to them. Because if we ain't part of that solution, we part of that problem. Okay. We part of that problem. And I heard the young people from the CIS talking, and the judge who was in the room, I heard her, and she's listening. But I hope she acted on everything that she said she was going to try to do. Because it's real. Mm-hmm. And y'all, the ones that's in the CIS program, man, y'all got little siblings, cousins, or something, man, let them catch y'all doing the right thing, not the wrong thing. Y'all are their role models. They looking at y'all. They looking at y'all. And if y'all don't fix this problem, they will be the next ones in that system. In that system, y'all. Y'all got to get it together, especially our young men. Y'all got to get it together, man. Like real rap. Enough is enough. It's time to, you know, step up and say, you know what? I got to show them something positive. Enough is enough. Ain't no playing with the plastic guns and stuff. You see the mothers taking them to the store, buying the plastic guns, and I say, you know what? I don't mean no disrespect, but you ain't getting him that gun. Get him a book.
Right.
Get him a book. Plastic guns, water guns, none of that. It's the mind thing, y'all. We got to get them out of that mindset. For real. But I just want to say, you know what I mean? And I know y'all don't know me, but I do. I want to say this. I want to say that I love y'all. even though y'all don't know me, I love y'all. Because guess what? God is love. I love y'all. And anything that I can do to help get y'all whatever y'all need, help, talk, whatever, we here. And that's real.
Thank you so much to all the panelists. We're going to move into the question and answer period now. I'm honored to be here with the work that all of you have done and all the accomplishments and heart and time you've put into this. And I'm just very impressed with everything that you've done. I'm proud we're here. So now we're going to move on to question and answer. Before we move on to that little housekeeping, we are being live streamed right now onto the internet. So if you don't feel comfortable being on video, please raise your hand right now and we can make sure that the videographer can avoid you. Anybody? Okay, everybody's ready to hand it up. With that said, I really appreciate it if you have questions, which we're excited for you to have the chance to talk with the panelists about, to try to keep them focused and we can keep this dialogue going back and forth and get as many people's voices heard today as possible. So we'll start here in the front and go ahead. And please speak up.
Okay, the so-called criminal justice system is like the Holy Roman Empire, which you may remember from high school, was neither holy nor Roman nor an empire. The so-called criminal justice system has nothing to do with justice and nothing to do with the system. It is, however, criminal. There's so many reforms that are needed. And in marvelous spokespeople, we need all kinds of reforms, starting with abolishing capital punishment, abolishing solitary confinement, stop building more prisons. That's for starters. Now, some people know, I'm a Democratic committee person, and by nature, a reformist. When possible, we should make changes by gradual reforms. But the so-called criminal justice system, the reforms, needs a lot more than reform. It needs fundamentally rethought, fundamentally redone. What the foundations of a system that's really about public safety would be protection. We know there are people out there that are a danger to themselves or others, and they need to be restrained in some fashion.
Right. These are excellent points. I feel like people are really feeling you. Is there a question that you want to go ahead and get to so the panelists can share with back and forth?
Yeah, I'm trying to wrap it up. The system needs restitution where possible, like paying for a busted window. Needs a figuring out who did what, responsibility, and it needs treat people who commit violent crimes, are a danger to themselves or others. As many people here know, that is the legal definition of commendably insane.
Well, thank you for making your point. We have a lot of other people. I appreciate it. And everyone can come and talk to them afterwards if you want to continue to hear these thoughts. They're really valuable thoughts. We're going to move on. Thank you for. Thank you. Thanks. It is a matter of commitment. You make some really great points. And I think other people, we can continue these conversations after Q&A. There are a lot of people that want to join in. It's a great conversation that you're helping us kick off. Okay, up here in the front. Yeah. Go ahead. Do you have a question or a comment? Can you speak up too? Because we really want to hear what you have to say. So if you don't mind standing and trumpeting a little.
Well, for me, I think it's best for like all kids to stay in school and do what they're supposed to do and do good and get good grades. and don't do nothing wrong.
That's a great comment. Okay, let me hear behind you.
Henry Jackson, I'd like to know what a good alternative to solitary confinement is. I think solitary confinement is terrible, but there are people, whether they're in jail or not, who maybe need their fanny smacked or their hands slapped. How do we deal with these misbehavior within the system, within a prison, without putting them in solitary? What should they do instead of solitary?
Great question. Okay, so are there panelists, if you can show me with your hands, who would like to answer that?
Well, I think people, you know, I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with single cells, but people need human contact. They need to be able to socialize. As it is now with solitary, you're stuck in your cell on the weekends 24 hours on Saturday and Sunday. And the only contact you have with other human beings is when the guards come and shackle you for some reason, you know. So I think it's the human contact. There should be opportunities for socializing in the prison system, as there is in for people who are not on solitary.
Are there any other panelists who'd like to give a response to the alternative to solitary confinement? And we can move on. Okay, next question. Let's move in the back here. Get your hand raised. Go ahead.
So
we're up.
They going to pay you or something for you? They don't pay you.
Yeah. Not even sorry.
I had an uncle. I mean, he got accused of raping somebody. He did like 19 years. He got out. Yeah. And they gave him a couple million dollars.
Yeah, I know. I don't know. No. I'm going to keep it funky with you. No. At all. And they don't, man, this thing, that's how real this thing is. They don't care. Like, they were actually mad at the lawyer for representing me the way that he did. Seriously, like, that's how deep it got. They were mad at him, man. Like, he was getting funny stares in the hallways when he went to work the next day. They don't care, man. That's how real it is.
But the thing about that is, he was a godly man. You know what I mean? He believed in God. So it didn't matter what man thought. You know what I mean? And that was my whole point of moving forward, even after they offered us a deal. They offered us a deal, and I'm like, babe, don't take that deal, because when you believe in God, you don't have to make no deals with nobody. God is the ultimate. You know what I mean? So we don't have to take a deal. So I told my husband, I said, give them their deal back, because we don't have to make a deal with nobody. You got to believe.
Okay, we're going to move to the next question here. Yes,
I'm a physician. I'm a psychiatrist. I actually volunteered for the Prison Society back in the late 80s. Might have been into the early 90s. And this was, remember when they had that big lawsuit, human rights lawsuit about medical care? I surreptitiously gave the lawyers that took the case, that filed the case, medical records from inmates because I walked into the Prison Society. I, like you, felt people were there. They must have been there, and it really opened my eyes. So I would tell everybody here, volunteer to do prison work. It would be a real eye-opener. But one of the things I learned was that the medical conditions in Pennsylvania prisons were so abysmal that they weren't even accredited. They couldn't even get accreditation. And that's how I got into feeding all these records to the I don't remember whether it was the ACLU or what, medical records. I would just ask prisoners to sign consent. As I came across a prisoner, he couldn't get his insulin, a guy who couldn't get his cast off for months and so on. But the question I have is, I wanted to know if there has been any improvement in the situation medically, or is there still egregious and medical conditions in the prison? Have they made any improvement at all? So you're telling me no. It's still the same. And as for this guy said something, I'll just say real quick and then I'll sit down, about alternatives. First of all, a lot of people don't realize that the United States, Amnesty International has a whole section on human rights abuses in prisons, in the prison systems of the United States. Okay? So the U.S. is... is that, and on top of that, the U.S. incarcerates more people than, it might be any other country in the world. I think it's any other country in the world. A lot of the human rights abuses occur in these federal, big federal lockdowns like Marion and in solitary confinement. There are a lot of alternatives. There are a lot of countries, Europe, Latin America, there are a lot of countries where they have a lot of other alternatives to which are rehabilitation rather than punishment. And there are a lot of studies that show that probably 85% of people who are in prisons in the United States do not need to be there, that could be rehabilitated and made functioning members of society out. So there's a small contingent who may need to be in prison, but they don't need to be treated inhumanely, maybe about 15%. But and there's a lot of abuses of juveniles. I'll stop and just say this real quick. I went on a tour with a group of kids who had psychiatric problems. So the place I was working at, they decided to take them on a tour of Allegheny County Jail. We had to stop the tour because, to our horror, the warden there started talking to the kids about how if they're bad, they sick people on them to rape them. I couldn't believe what he was saying. Nobody could believe. We never went back to do a visit again. He didn't use the words rape, but he described, you know, that's what he described, and we were shocked. But now I know that a lot of that does go on in prisons and jails. There's a lot of one of the human rights abuses is raping of not just female prisoners. And you probably know about this raping, because I learned this when I was working as a volunteer. There's a lot of raping of male prisoners as a form of punishment.
Right.
So,
and I was right now in County.
It's huge.
Yes, actually, would you like to respond and talk a little bit about the
I wanted to talk about the medical that she raised. In Pennsylvania, the nurses work for the state, but the doctors work for a contractor.
Right.
So the problem is that the contract work, their objective is to treat the prisoners as little as possible.
That's right.
You know, because the more they treat, obviously, costs more money. So they're trying to keep their costs down. And so that's why, part of the reason why the medical treatment is so abysmal. But with respect to the other case in Allegheny County, Nicoletti, I think is his name, he is on trial now for raping people at SCI Pittsburgh, I believe.
Yeah.
That trial, I think, is going on right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have a question for this lady here.
Okay. Panelists on panelists questions. Okay. Cut the line for that. Go ahead, Gloria.
Yes. In the prison system, they transfer people after they get them to some place like Camp Hill. That's just a holding place for the slave ship, because that's what it is, a slave ship on dry land.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But needless to say, you've already heard that.
Yeah.
But they're responsible for the transportation the whole time. And if there's an accident, there was an accident out in where they're closing, like whoever said, Pine Grove and Crescent, they're closing them down for that reason. There was a great big accident, big one. People got killed and everything. They kept it hush-hush because everybody was saying they heard it in Philadelphia, and they would call. They said, "Did you hear so-and-so?" "No, I heard nothing." They didn't put it on the news here. Okay? So they keep a lot of stuff hush here. There's a whole bunch of stuff here going on, what you already know. But what I wanted to ask you, if they have something happen to your son or your daughter, whoever, that's being transferred, and they've been immobilized or seriously hurt to the point where it's going to affect their life forever, there's no recompense. You know, they fix it so that by the time they get through, they don't, like whoever just stood, they just came out, you came out, and they're not giving you anything. You should be able to get something anyway. But anyway, I will follow that through because they took your life, you know. So what I'm saying is, who do you go to when these atrocities happen? You know, somebody's in a van going from one prison to another, you know, because after they leave Camp Hill, they get to another place.
Right.
Okay. And they're there in the hospital 3 months or whatever, They, you know, their heads just about gone and everything else, and they hide it amongst themselves. Like, you know, the public doesn't even get to know. And the people that did know was like, oh, they're going to get money. What did they bring them through our town for? Now the state's going to, you know what I'm saying? The whole public's attitude towards prisoners, if they actually knew what prisoners went through, you know, it's at their discretion who becomes a prisoner. That's number one.
So you're also wondering about, is there anybody accountable for retribution or liabilities?
How far up that layer you go? Mm-hmm. All the way to the federal government, unless you go to the Supreme Court itself.
You could try filing a civil suit against... But
you only have a certain amount of time. You have like less than, they say, like 3 months.
Well, usually states have immunity, so you can't even...
Right.
You can't even sue the state.
Or right.
You could try, but right. You're not going to get anything, generally speaking.
That's a very hard area. Yes, let's go with the questions back here. I think you had your hand up with the hoodie on.
Speak up.
And yeah, we want to hear your question. Your question, is it for Terrell?
Yes, ma'am. I got one of my best friends is charged with triple homicide that he didn't do. And like everything you just said is like what they're doing with him. And he's been in jail for 2 years since he was 17. And I just want to know, like, do you think it would work out for him? Like, saying how it worked out for you?
He said he had a friend who's been wrong with him for 2 years.
So. Making sure I'm wrong. Like, if it wasn't for the grace of God, big homie, man, I wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
Like, I'm telling you, that's what you're doing, man. It don't work out for everybody. That shit's real. Like, some cats just won't die in there, man. Having, you know what I mean? And they ain't had nothing to do with it. It's just the way. Unless God, man, just destroy all of them jails, man, open up the doors and let everybody come home. Like, some of the homies is going to die in there, man. So I ain't going to sit here and tell you that it is or that it ain't with him. You know what I mean? What I'm going to tell you is, if you talk to him, when you talk to him, when you write him, because I hope you're doing all those things, man. Tell him to stay in that law library, man.
Yeah.
Tell him to go to that chapel, get right with God. You understand what I'm saying? Because that's the only thing that's going to make the difference, yo. You can't depend on the lawyers. He got 2 years in already. Like, he went in when he was 17. There's a good chance he don't know nothing about the law. So he I ain't going to lie, I don't know.
I would say my opinion of that, I always look at the flip side of that. God just moving him out of the way for a minute because he knew that he was into some stuff. You know what I mean? And he may not have done that crime, but just for God to get his undivided attention and say, I'm going to move you out of here, move you somewhere where I got your undivided attention, is possible.
It's possible.
Anything's possible. But he got to build his own personal relationship up with God. You know what I mean? It ain't going to take no money, none of that. We didn't pay a dime for a lawyer. But that's just how God works. He said, I don't give you the spirit of distress or the fear. He didn't give us no spirit of distress. Now, we went through it. Don't get us wrong. Me and him almost had to go to blows about that deal because he's like, listen, I'm ready to come home.
Now.
Mm-hmm. And I said, listen. Take that deal, I'm gone. And I know it was selfish, but I knew God had a bigger plan. So I'm saying, your homie, he has to have his own personal relationship. And I always say, if he really didn't do it, then God got a plan for him.
Here, when you write him, and I'm telling you, man, write your homeboys, anybody else that's locked up, write him, man. Don't cost nothing, man. You know what I mean? Stamp ain't about nothing. Some paper, take you 5 minutes, man. Writing, man, telling you to get in that law library, yo.
And study. And get with someone who knows that law.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
For real.
Telling to write everybody in the country, every innocent project there is, yeah. Man.
And it's real. You know what I mean? The system has become a business. It's a business.
That's right.
It's a business now. You know what I mean? Everybody making money hand over glove. You know what I mean? Everybody, the guards got percentage in. Everybody got a percentage in on that jail system. It's a business. That's why they're closing up our schools.
Right.
And it's important for y'all who's 18 and older to vote. Y'all get these judges in for real, quiet as cat. Y'all don't even know. But y'all are the ones that can get these judges in, and y'all are the ones that can get them out of here.
Mm.
But y'all better wake up.
That's
so we can get that law.
Judge elections are this year.
That's right. Well, we have about to vote them out.
We have about 5 minutes left, and we're going to try to keep everybody that's trying to get a question in. Especially if you have a question for the panelists, go ahead.
What is death row?
What is death row? Is that what you said? Yeah, the answer. Who would like to answer that question? And please speak up.
When you're convicted, when you're charged with murdering somebody, sometimes you can be placed on what's called death row, which means that you are going to be executed or killed by the state. So when, you know, not everybody, only about 1% of the murders, which is one of the problems with the death penalty, it's very arbitrary. Only 1% of people who commit murder end up on death, or what's called death row. And that just means that you are being slated for, that means that eventually you will be killed by the state. So the state is saying it's wrong to kill, but the state will kill you if you kill somebody else.
Oh, well, makes a lot of sense.
If you have a death penalty, can't the person that, like, can't they have a plea bargain which makes you not have the death penalty, but like, in jail or probation or something like that?
Yeah, that's what happens a lot sometimes. In fact, serial killers often end up serving life without parole because, you know, to avoid the death penalty. Yeah, that happens a lot.
Next question in the back.
I just wanted to ask you briefly to the as far as people being convicted innocently. And I think a lot of focus has to be, and I believe there's right and wrong in everything, and I agree with the young lady up here. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I don't know what a lot of times families would do. But one thing I do know, a lot of times the lawyers have to be, who's screening the lawyers? That's my thing, because I have a family member that has put a lot of money into a lawyer, all the money that they had, because they were accused of something and they were innocent of it. They're serving time in prison. This lawyer never even came and spoke to this family member. He kept trying to call and get in contact, because I know that's one of the things that they do say, to get in contact with your lawyer. Never even came and spoke to this individual. The individual is serving time in prison right now. The lawyer has his money, but here he's serving time and he's innocent, you know. And I said, if it wasn't for the grace of God, and like you said, I do believe that God has a plan for his life. But, you know, that's one case in a million. So, and like I said, there is good and bad and everything. But who's holding these lawyers accountable that are taking this money, but they're not doing anything to defend the person, you know?
Great question. Well, I look at that situation, what I just stated to this young man, like, it ain't about the money. It's about that personal relationship with the Lord. You know what I mean? And I say that because we thought it was about the money too. Until we were straddled on that fence and we was like, are we going to trust God or is we going to trust man? And God made sure that we didn't have enough money to pay the lawyer. So he said, what you going to do now? So once he said, what you going to do now, he was all we had. You know what I mean? So once we just said, okay, we all in, that's when doors start opening up. He said, I got your attention now. It ain't about that money. It ain't about man. It's about that personal relationship with him and the Lord. That's how I seen it. So.
Right. But my thing is, how about the ones that are going and they're putting all this money into the system, you know what I mean, into these lawyers. And, I mean, the lawyers are not doing their job, you know. And I know it's up to whoever, you know, the offender is to get in touch with the lawyers, but they're trying to get in touch with these lawyers and they're not able to get in touch with them, you know. And their youth, they're taking the money, but they're not doing their job, you know. And I think that's a sad thing. And that does happen in the system, you know. And it's just sad.
Nobody. That's just the reality. Like, they play God with our lives.
They did.
day in and day out. This is what they do, and they don't feel like, even to the family that's giving them the money. They know you don't know nothing about the law. And they're going to make you believe that they're doing everything that they should in order to save your child's life. Lawyer tell me at the end of the whole process, man, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. How's that going to help? I'm not going home today. You're going home. And even if he did feel sad, it didn't change the fact that you didn't put these witnesses on the stand. So, and I give you this. What they've also done as far as the system, as we call, that's what we're calling it. They made it to where as there's not enough time between the time you get convicted and the time you have to file your appeal to learn anything about the law. They're giving you a total amount of maybe like a year. Now you're coming off of the streets. You're ignorant to this process. Smoking weed, drinking, living your life. You could have been just a regular citizen doing nothing but going to work all day long, every day. But you know nothing about the legal system, filing briefs and stuff like this. These people went to school for this for years, and they're still not that good at it. You understand what I'm saying? So here you are, right off of the streets, been in jail maybe like, you know, 6 months to a year, on trial for 4 days or however long the trial took. Now you're off on some bus to who knows where, and you're in the law library, and you don't even know where to start. This is what, and they're telling you, ignorance is not an excuse. This is what they tell you, ignorance is not an excuse. You should, as if we, as regular citizens, should just know the laws. Now I'm telling you, if you break the laws, you need to know how much time you're gonna get for the laws that you're breaking.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's only right, do your homework, right? But. To answer your question, nobody.
I confess I'm a lawyer.
Right.
I confess I'm a lawyer. I do not practice criminal law. Well, we are correct. I don't do criminal law at all because the system is so messed up.
Right. We have one more response, actually, to this question.
I wasn't clear from the question whether she was talking about a public defender or a private lawyer.
It seemed like you were talking about both lawyers in general and then specifically the private lawyers who are also making a lot of money off of defending people who don't end up getting justice. So just who's holding lawyers accountable?
Were you talking about a private lawyer that you paid?
Private lawyer, mostly.
Okay. Well, one recourse that you have is to go to the disciplinary board in Pennsylvania and file a complaint that you aren't represented properly. There is a fund which lawyers pay into every year for victims of bad lawyers. And you could try to go that route, and sometimes it works. You know, sometimes it doesn't. It depends on how politically hooked up the lawyer is, you know, that sort of thing. But it is one avenue to try.
So at this point, as much as I will say, one good sign of a panel is that there are still questions when the Q&A is shut down, actually. So is there somebody really?
He had his hand.
Okay. Can you make a quick comment or question?
Very quick.
Thanks, Rob.
I'm Roger Thomas. I'm the co-chairman of the Pennsylvania Committee for the Study and Reform of the Criminal System. We were appointed to that position several years ago by the governor. I want everybody to notice that there are positive things happening, and we are making progress in the reform of the criminal system. There are three things that are happening right now. First and foremost, and I'm asking your active support, we are reintroducing the Racial Justice Act. And the Racial Justice Act provides that if racism was a vector in the determination of a prosecution or sentence in capital case, that is now admissible. That is the point of the law. I need you to support me because 67% of the people on death row are black, okay? They only commit 53% of the homicides. They're grossly overrepresented. We need to get this statute passed. We've already been able to get several statutes passed. We are making progress in Pennsylvania. The second thing you need to know is that, speaking to your issue, we have introduced the Juvenile Justice Act, and in the Juvenile Justice Act, any time a juvenile is sentenced to hard time, which is 10 years, they have the right to have a re-sentencing hearing in front of the judge, in front of the sentencing judge, to determine their individual culpability. The reason this is so important is a thing called the felony homicide rule. And under the felony homicide rule, everybody who is around at the time that a homicide occurs in the course of another felony, they are all identified as co-conspirators, and they're all sentenced under second-degree homicide. This is bad law, and I need your help in getting the Racial Justice Act passed. I need your help in getting the Juvenile Justice Act passed, and I'll talk to you a little later about what we're doing about witness identification and his specific problem about snitch testimony. I need your help on getting the Racial Justice Act passed. I have petitions that I'd like to circulate, and I'm done.
Thank you. Do you have a website or anything that you can tell us about?
Or a table downstairs?
I'll be downstairs.
Okay. Yeah, look downstairs. So again, did you want to say something else?
I just want y'all to know, man, that y'all can go on poorlaw.org, man, and y'all can find out about our organization. It's poorlaw.org. Y'all can find out more about our organization.
Again?
Poor law.
Yeah, that's a great way to get involved and take it to the next step. Yep. And again, those of you who still have some questions, I know we didn't get to everybody. That's why we want these conversations to continue. Feel free to talk to all of these panelists throughout the day, at lunch, and enjoy. Thank you so much. And one more round of applause, please.